thank you so much for taking the time to join us. This is the first in our seminar series, our COVID, you know, lockdown digital seminar series, where we've invited a distinguished guest, and we're delighted that you were able to join us. Silvia and I have talked about how to approach this, but for everyone else, we thought we'd take this in three parts. One is we would have a conversation, well, I say conversation, but Silvia will be doing most of the talking, a little bit about her own work over the last 35 years. She's, as most of you know, she's written over 100 papers, 35 books. She's been working since the 80s. So she's really seen a number of really significant turns in organizational studies. And partly from my own interest, but I think partly it's relevant to us all, we want to dwell in the second part on recent work. Silvia's done some really interesting recent writings at the intersection of practice and affect theory, notions like affective ethnography, the post-human turn. So certainly I'm interested in hearing as much as possible about your thinking there, Silvia. And then the third part, which will be at least half of it, we want to take questions and comments and have a more collective conversation. Hopefully by that time, Silvia, we will have worked out that you can see people's faces.
I hope so.
Yeah. And I also just want to do one thing before we formally launch, Silvia, which you might have encountered in Australia before, but I wanted to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land, the Woiwurrung people and the Boonwurrung language groups of the Eastern Kulin Nations. And in fact, all the traditional custodians on all of the unceded lands in Australia where we conduct the business of the University of RMIT, including the Waterwurrung people of the Bellarine Peninsula where I live. So we acknowledge the traditional custodians and their ancestors, yes, past and present. Yes. So Silvia, you know, just before we get into your work itself, I thought it'd be interesting for you to give us a sense of why you entered academia. What drew you in? What were the questions back in the late 70s and the early 80s that turned your mind towards this endeavor?
Well, Julian, first, let me thank you for the work that you have done and the way that you went through my curriculum. And then I realized that you took almost 40 years of my life, my academic career, you put it together. So you found out a period before, so to say, the before practice turn, the practice turn, and the contemporary practice turn. And but I don't want to spend too much time in, so to say, in the first 20 years of my career. First of all, I don't know why I joined and I became an academic. I would say by chance, because I never, going to the academy was not my dream. I was more a sort of activist, feminist activist. I think that, well, in order to understand my work, I think that you have to understand that, so to say, I was born feminist, and feminist thinking is in my background. I didn't have a high idea of the academia, and still I think that academia is a morally despicable place to be and to work. But so in the beginning, I was doing research, empirical research. Keep in mind that I'm still a sociologist working in the faculty of sociology. So you see, even if I have always been in contact with people from business school, I think that the disciplinary background is very important for me. So that in the beginning, the places where I did empirical research, and I was training to do empirical research, were like cooperatives, trade unions, women association, women movement, social entrepreneurship. And then the 80s were the years where organizational theory was highly criticized for being rational. You know, the rational paradigm in organization studies was really under attack. So in the 80s were the years where I was interested in organizational culture, in all those aspects of the organization that were beyond rationality. SCOS, a standing working group on organizational symbolism. So you see, since the beginning, an interest for me was the limits of rationality, who is the rational actor, and also knowledge, whose knowledge, and so on. And this is something that I brought with me since the beginning.
Silvia, if I look at that early phase, and admittedly a lot of it's in Italian, so I can't read it, but you began with this interest in grounded theory and I guess the work of Barry Turner in terms of organizational symbolism.
Yes.
So what were your predominant occupations or your interests at that time? Was it moving away from the sort of positivist rational actor type approach to organizational studies in that period?
Yes. And also that time I was studying decision making. I was not satisfied with the way that decision-making were presented. My first two books in Italian were on decision-making. And then my contribution, I would say, to decision-making was to look at the discursive practices while doing decision-making. So you see my interest, I translated into Italian Jim March books. So my interest were around all the problem and the question, the limits of rationality and of cognitivist in organization studies. And in fact, this is something that is going back in the 80s, but this is what brought me, if you want, to practice theory and to continue this interest through practice. I would say that for a sociologist, practice theory was not something new, especially because, well, not only because of Bourdieu, Giddens, but even before the contribution of ethnomethodology and ethnography, that not everybody consider ethnomethodology as part of practice theories, but actually ethnomethodology was, if you want, was the beginning, and not only in methodological terms, but also because the problem was to discover the ethnomethod that people use in everyday business. And that is the main interest behind practice theory. And then, you know, you develop also something in relation to the kind of research that you are doing. So that in the time when, well, that was some years before the special issue in organization on practice-based theorizing on learning and knowing was came out in 2000, and now I tell you how this special issue came about. But in those years, I would say we, because at that time Davide Nicolini was working with me in Trento. And so that around 94, 98, we were involved in a large project on organizational learning that was coordinated by the WSB of Berlin. And so there were around 20 projects going on in Europe on this theme, And Davide and me and other people, we were working on a project like title was Do Organizations Learn from Accident? And if you want, this was at the beginning, because instead of thinking what safety is, we turn the point around and we say how safety is done and how safety is done in situated practices. So that was, if you want, was the beginning of what is the real turn in practice, in thinking about from question of ontology, what safety is, to question of epistemology, how safety is done. And so in that time, our interest for going back to practice theory and mainly in ethnomethodological, ethnographic interest, because we were looking, so to say, from the beginning, how a novice get into a construction site up to how safety is done through regulation at the European level. So we were following practices and how these practices were connected to one another. So what was inside the texture of practices. And I think that this was the first moment, and also was the moment where we did also another, if you want, we took another concept and we turned it upside down, that is knowledge. So that knowledge, instead of being a thing, knowledge is, and we define it as an activity, and as a situated activity, something people do, and not only situated practices, but also in communities of practice. So that knowing as an activity, as a collective knowledgeable activity, and knowing not separated from working and from innovating and from changing. So that was our interest and our take on practice, thinking that practice was the place, so to say, the symbolic place where knowing take place. So, and where knowledge is kept. So you see, when we wrote the first chapter of this special issue that I mentioned, the idea, well, at the beginning of the story was like being in between Scylla and Charybdis, that also this is very Italian, and the two monsters, and Ulysses has to pass in between. So the two monsters were on one side, let's say Scylla was the cognitivist,
mentalist box. Version, vision of knowledge in organizations, the individual cognitive mode, right? And Charybdis was a commodification of knowledge.
Versus the commodification of knowledge. So that we, the reason for rediscovering and for bringing practice theories back, for me is back, because being a sociologist, practice was always there in my background. So to say that knowledge not only is kept within practices, so that all the literature on community of practice was very present, not only, but also with the community of practice, we switched the concept, because instead of saying the community and the practices, the community, we say that practices enact the community.
Yeah.
So this is
Yes,
please.
So this is great. This lays out, you've jumped into what I've called phase two of your, your mid phase, right? Where you really, as much as anybody in organization studies, introduce the notion of practice, linked various traditions within practice theory and into organization studies. You also responded a lot to the ideas of the learning organization at the time. You wrote that paper, Diverging Communities of Practice. And you wanted to contrast, if I've read it correctly, a sort of reified notion of a learning organization that consultants were running around saying they would build, or the work of Peter Senge, et cetera, from this idea of learning within organizations as a situated activity. And it's a moment again when we're all facing as staff here, you know, a lot of pressure on learning, reskilling, learning inside organizations, learning out. I wonder if you could recapitulate those debates at the time and where you position your own work within that.
Yeah. Yes, that was what was going on, so to say, around toward the end of the 90s, and this is also within this conversation is where the network of before organizational learning people and then is the OLKC network. And that was the beginning toward the end of the 90s when Mark Esterbith-Smith put together the first meeting, and I and David, we were there since the beginning. And in that time, and in fact, from one of these conferences, I can't remember if it was the first or the second, came that introduction that came out from that seminar. And at that time, the tension between the two communities, those who were going more toward organizational learning, so organizational learning as a process taking place into organizations, and the learning organization community, more like, I say reifying knowledge, and that being the learning organization was an attribute of the organization, and then much more oriented toward consultancy and so on. So that was a tension between in the literature and between the people participating and so on. I think that nowadays, many things change so that this tension is not so strong as it was more than 20 years ago. I would say also maybe because in the meantime, practice theories came in, so that what is learning and a social theory of learning instead of a cognitivist one, yeah, took place. So if you have a look at the journal The Learning Organization, even if the title keep the label The Learning Organization, is less has changed a lot. Then, you know, I never liked to work in contraposition with other theories or in criticizing other position. I think that I prefer to bring forward a proposition, what I think, rather than making opposition and working on opposition, because this put also barriers toward the others that I like, so to say. So I prefer.
I want to ask you about that just before we break into questions, but I was thinking it'd be interesting to move into the recent phase as well. So this sort of where you've been talking with the work that you began in the 90s and really continued up to today, but there was a turn that I detect from 2010 onwards, where you started to explore the post-human turn, post-qualitative methodologies, sometimes called. You started looking at affect, including Deleuze and Guattari, etc. So tell us a bit about what inspired that interest, and was there anything that you detected that was insufficient with the practice-based approaches you looked at up until that point?
Let me step back for a moment. You know, I'm thinking in the beginning I put you forward toward the practice term, and now I'm going a moment back, because I think that in thought, there is always a development in thoughts that correspond to the kind of research that you are doing in the time. So before going on to so to say, the what I have been doing in the last 10 years, let me go back to what I was going to say in the beginning, how the special issue of organization came out in 2000. It was, I want to stress that it was 2000, because meaning that in organization studies, the, so to say, if you want, the fashion with practice theories came out, because it was published 1 year before Shatsky, Fontarini, and Karin Norsetina collection came out, because it came out in 2001. So if you want this step toward rediscovering practice theory was done before in and being done before meant that also we were less linked to the classic, the second wave practice theories, and more proposing to look and to propose practice-based studies as a way of taking practice as epistemology. So was already a move towards post-structuralist, post-epistemologies, and so on. And this special issue came out from a symposium that with Davide Nicolini and Dvorah Janov, we organized at the Academy of Management in 1998. So in this symposium, we put together a stream of thought that were striving with similar problems around the limits of rationality, about either activity or practice. So that at this symposium, we took community of practice people, so to say, represented by Etienne Wenger, activity theory with Frank, it was not Frank Blackler who was there. No, also Frank Blackler was there, and Yurio Engenstrom was there for activity theory. Then for actor network theory, there was the paper by Davide Nicolini and me, and the paper by Lucy Sashman. And then there was the cultural view on organization learning represented, so to say, by Dvorah Janov. And yes, what I want to say is that this special issue was important because was not much going back to the tradition of Bourdieu, Shatsky, Giddens, but neither Shatsky, who in a sense appeared later on the stage. So that was an important moment, if you want, also because in organization theory, we moved from the 80s when rationalism was under attack to a question, what comes out afterwards? What come out afterward when knowledge, knowing is an activity and knowing in practice? Julianne, I see you almost quiet, so I wonder if you still listen to me.
I'm totally listening. I was trying to pull on the link. Yeah, you can hear me, right? Yeah, because I was asking about your interest in the last 10 years, and I've got a hypothesis for, you've read some of my work, I think, around, I've got, I guess, a critique of tendencies towards practice and that way of looking at the world and what it might neglect. But I'm curious what motivated you to look beyond or between practice, if you like. And you went back to discussing that the special issue where you started to link actor network theory and ethno-methodological approaches and activity theory, etc. All of the different strains that ended up in David Nicolini's book on practice theory, in a way. So I was just trying to, understand why you went back to that link. Was there something in there that had the seeds of your interest moving beyond practice theory?
No, I wouldn't say beyond, because this was the possibility that practice theory was giving. Also because what is important, and was what has been always important, is the reflection on methodology. So that if you want, the practice is also what allows you to go beyond the distinction theory and method. I think you have to consider that in those years, around the 20, in our department in Trento, we set up RUCOLA, Research Unit on Organizational Communication, Organizational Learning and Aesthetics, and the A of aesthetics means that Antonio Strati was there with us, was part of the group, and he brought to practice theory all that has to do with, of course, with the aesthetics, so through knowing through the senses. And this links very well with the reflection on the body, and not only with a phenomenological sensibility, but also with link with the post-human orientation and the feminist new materialism. So that the issue about vital matter, the vitality of matter, is what came out also from a long-lasting interest in methodology. If you consider we took up also back in the 2000 time what was the interview with Double that I develop in the book on decision, on micro decision making in the 95, grounded theory shadowing that we use in working with women entrepreneurs. So there was an interest toward inventive and creative methodologies and in aesthetics that was part of a RUCOLA project, and that continue in the most recent theorization. I think that in organization studies, the interest for forms of post epistemologies and post qualitative research is linked to the name and to the work of by Wanda Orlikowski, but Wanda, Wanda Orlikowski has done is to introduce the concept of entanglement, but also the work of Karen Barad in relation to technology, in relation to materiality. And also Lucy Sachman took the idea of the situatedness of knowledge. I mean, the tradition from Donna Haraway in organization studies. And so this is the continuation of a reflection on feminist new materialism. And my contribution in this, if I think at the article in 2017, the one that it is in the book, The Nexus of Practices, was to say that social materiality refers not only to technology, to artifacts, but also to the body. So that the first materiality that we have is through the bodies and through being bodies connected to other bodies, so social materiality. I stop a little moment before going on because I see you quite frozen. I'm not sure if it is only the image, but
can you hear me okay? Can you hear me?
Okay. Is it fine, the video?
I can hear you fine. Sylvia, I actually thought we might open up to our colleagues for questions.
Can little things more, because you are pushing me to toward affect and so on. So I was saying that the post-human orientation comes from feminist new materialism with the work of Karen Barad, but also with the work by Rosie Braidotti. So links to post-anthropocentrism and especially to immanent ethics. So the work on Deleuze and Guattari and their translation, Brian Masumi, and the point about affect. So so that the question that is put in practice-based studies is what kind of knowing subject are we becoming? And then what possibilities for research on practice may be? So this is, this is where I stop. So let's put the question and maybe we can go back if there are more things.
Yeah. So let me do, so for everybody else, this is very much the time for questions and microphones and hand raises and all the rest, videos on. I don't know if Sylvia, you can see anyone else now, but just to do.
Now you are not frozen, you are still
alive.
Okay, this is all, is already.
I just want to summarize a couple of points because some of this, you know, I've had about 30 Gherardi papers open on my computer the last few days. So some of these terminology is quite familiar to me, but if you haven't had your head in this stuff, it might seem a little bit novel. So we were just talking about some more recent turns in ontology and certainly methodology and epistemology beyond or adjacent to practice-based approaches. And one of those, and perhaps this might be the first question, Joe, was the notion of post-qualitative inquiry. Another one is the sort of post-human turn and Olakowski's social materiality. And the other is affect theory as well. So I'll open the floor, but it was just to repeat some of those concepts that were hanging out there. Joe.
Thanks very much, Jules and Sylvia. How lovely to see you and hear you. It's been fantastic. Thank you very much. I am a traditional qualitative scholar. In fact, I do case study mainly in industrial relations. That's a whole nother story, but I'm interested in the notion of how we move beyond traditional qualitative approaches to towards the sort of approaches you're suggesting.
Now, Sylvia, can you hear us? Because you're...
Not only that, I can see you when somebody else is talking. Then pop, I'm so happy. nice that I could see. I have not seen the name, but are you Joanna?
I am, yes.
Okay, so I could see Joanna. And thank you for your question. My answer is quite brief, because there is a huge community working under the title of post-qualitative, mainly in education and education scholar. By the way, a lot of people are in Australia, Australia, America, well, not only. And I think that there is more a question than answer. And the question around post-qualitative and how to develop post-qualitative ways of doing research, from what on one side means that means the dissatisfaction with, you know, like processes like coding, and so so to say, like the way of treating qualitative data as if they were something stable data, yes. Capta. And the question is, if we take the concept of entanglement seriously, meaning that in a research assemblage, I prefer to say a research agencement, but if in a research assemblage, the researcher is inside, is entangled with the people in the research assemblage, with all the materialities and so on, so that if we are looking at a process of becoming where nothing is fixed and everything is entangled, how is it possible to do research? You see, this is the big question that qualitative research put, and then how can we invent different ways of doing things. I think that this is very important, because it moves us, or better, push us very forward about different epistemologies, different ways of doing research, different ways of representing research, so that the detached observer is no longer there, no?
Yes, thank you.
And here is where affect and affect studies come in. Stop here.
And if I might have a brief follow-up from my own experience in doing case study research, many industrial relations scholars still do a version of case study research that leans more towards the rationalist approach. You know, we'll tell the story, we'll look at the timeline, we'll talk to the people and triangulate. And they're very resistant, perhaps because of their disciplinary training, to the idea of taking a more interpretivist approach, or seeing it as a little bit less certain. But perhaps that's a disciplinary thing that that might take time to change.
Yes, I agree with you.
So I think Warren and or Cam, Cam's got his head up. Warren, you had your microphone on, so go for it.
Cam, go first, and then I'll jump in.
Thanks, Warren. Thanks, Silvia. Can you hear me? It's Cameron Duff here. Nice to see you again.
Hear you? I hope. Oh, I can see you. Nice to see
nice
you.
Nice to see you. I'm sitting here with my wife in the sunshine, listening to your presentation, and both of us have just been commenting that your talk has warmed our hearts and reminded us of how much we miss this kind of conversation with our European colleagues in other parts of the world. I very much envy you being in Paris. That's something that a lot of us pre-COVID used to look forward to from time to time, conferences with European colleagues. So it's lovely to hear you speak. And it does remind us a little tiny bit of what that feels like, and particularly the wonderful exchange of ideas and the robust, you know, intellectual nourishment that you provide for us. So thank you very much. I had a question in addition to that comment, a question about, it strikes me that the way that Jules and you have kind of narrated your academic work over the last several decades, that a real feature has been taking particular sets of theoretical problems in different fields of inquiry and then applying them to interesting emergent problems in organizational studies. And that's so particularly with affect theory more recently, but as Jules has said, you know, reaching back to earlier theoretical terms in the social sciences. I guess my question is this, you know, in all the work that you've done with that, you know, it's quite hard to bring new theories and new ideas, new approaches into fields. Do you have any kind of insights or tips for us, if you like, any things that you've learned along the way that you feel have kind of made it easier to do that kind of translational work?
You are asking me for some trick of the trade.
That's right. Yes. I bet you've got a few.
Well, you push me toward the more reflexive stance. And as you know, in this case, I am blind to my own competence as any practitioner is. I think that the only thing I can answer is about curiosity. You say, right, in a sense, if you are driven by curiosity, you always think to you know, what looks new to you, what in post-qualitative circle they call data that glow, you know, something that suddenly pop up and you say, oh, this is interesting. So bring your passion forward, and curiosity is brought forward. And in a sense, also reach the limits of your knowledge of your research, because at the end you discover that you are always interested in the same kind of problem. You see, when I started thinking about rationality, I think that I do many turns, and then I go back to the beginning to say, what is that is not represented in rationality? What is beyond? What is, yeah, that is said? What is that is not in words? What is the invisible? What we do not see? What is that? What is what we ignore, not know, and ignore? So that in a sense, it's like going in turns. Curiosity brings you forward, and then your beginning of your interest reappear in new forms, in new ways, and you discover but that actually you keep being interested in something that you bring forward through the years, and you redefine and find something new. Well, thank you for this question. I never thought so clearly that when I talked.
I just thought that it's what you say about the idea of the kind of non-representational aspects of the settings and practices and behaviors we're interested in. You know, bringing that, I mean, curiosity seems to be the right kind of intellectual stance to bring to bear on those things, doesn't it? That's a really wonderful way of thinking about it.
Mm-hmm. Warren.
Turn my mic on. Hi, Silvia. I'm Warren. I've always kind of liked your writing and Davide Nicolini's writing about practice theory, because it made it feel for me accessible and kind of understandable, because it's an area with a lot of different strands, and you've kind of touched on some of those different ways of viewing. From that perspective, be it Shutsky or Olakowski, other types of ideas. I've found it complex in that space to kind of make a theoretical contribution that convinces others. And so I wondered if you might speak a little bit to that, because obviously you can be, you know, quite descriptive in your ethnographic work, but the bar for a lot of the top org studies, management studies journals are very clear theoretical contributions. And that's probably something that I'm still grappling with.
So how to answer? Well, in a sense, your question is about convincing the other, and this other in your talk are the journals. I can say that for me, or what I learned that is still very important, is something that, if I'm not wrong, Goffman wrote at the end of his little book on social interaction, something like that. And he was writing that a contribution, so a new contribution, or that your study, your research should give three contributions. And one contribution is a substantive contribution to the field of study that you are studying. If you study safety, you have to say something substantial about safety. Then a theoretical contribution and a methodological contribution. You see, these remarks stay with me forever. And very often when I read a dissertation, for example, I put the same question to the candidate, because I think that actually in thinking to a contribution, to a convincing contribution, I think that it is interesting to keep these three focus point. Then you see, then there is the problem of the journal where you are bringing me. And I know that, so to say, in order to be convincing, you shouldn't be too ahead of time, neither to be too back in time to what it has been written, because then this is widely known, but neither to be too much ahead. For example, I have one article that, by the way, I really love it, that had, in our understanding, the best award for the most rejected paper I ever had. And it is the article that at the end appeared in Qualitative Research on Organization and Management, the 2018, where we are putting this question: how can we, so to say, follow, represent, and to show where is affect in your research? So that we were, the title was something around tracking affect, tracking the social material traces of affect. So what we were looking for was how can we write, because, I mean, that there is affect in our research, in a sense, is self-evident. And in the same way, it's self-evident how we take this problematic and we throw it away because we don't know how to deal with this. In a sense, a little bit we deal through emotions, but it's quite poor. But otherwise, we throw away because we don't know how to do it. So this was our research question. How can I show you, as a reader who has not been there, that in our research there was this force, this intensity? How do we represent it? And if you want, in this sense, I link to the problem that Julian put forward in his writing, that is atmosphere, how I represent atmosphere. In a sense, atmosphere is the most easiest way of showing affect, you know, showing in the mean of convincing the reader, or of making affect an empirical thing for the moment being, no? Then you talk and about atmosphere. But then the big problem is how you bring all these elements in your research, in your empirical research. How can you represent it without being representationalist, and so on? And this is this was the paper that was in absolute was the most rejected paper in many journals. But finally, we managed to produce it and to see the traces of affect in the materiality of the interview, the voice, the written, our discussion, and so on and so on. And this is why I love it in particular.
Thanks. That makes me feel better about my own journal rejections, Silvia. It's always comforting to hear that top scholars also go through this. Elena has a question, but I'll let you ask that, Elena. I want to interject with a sort of provocation, and I'm going to put something in the chat stream too. But Silvia, when I was sort of glancing across your own intellectual journey and trying to map some of the changes potentially in your thinking, one of the really interesting concepts where I think that showed up is in your writing about gender. So you defined at the beginning of this as a feminist before you were a scholar. You wrote a very influential paper in human relations in the 90s about doing gender. It was sort of a practice. You foreshadowed a practice-based approach to thinking about gender, not as an attribute of individuals, a sort of natural property, if you like, but as this thing that we do and enact. And but then you also wrote what I thought might be taken as a provocative article a few years ago called Do We Need Gender Any Longer? Right? From if we practice posthumanist research, do we need gender any longer? Where you start to talk about the reification of the concept. So I wonder, we have a few scholars in our school and on this call that are interested in gender. So I wonder if you could elaborate on that a little bit.
Yeah, with pleasure. I think that, and the question that I put is, do we need gender as a term and the concept any longer? Because if you want, gender was an important concept a long time ago, and the passage from sex to gender to everything. But very often, or at least, there is a way of conceiving gender studies for gender link to inequality, to power relation, and so on. That is perfectly right, you know. But then the danger that comes with this formulation of gender studies linked to inequalities, discrimination, and so on, is to restrict the gender only to these studies, you know. And then you have the other, so that you have a feminist scholar just working with this kind of problems and stuff that are very important. I'm not denying it at all. But not looking at the other way of considering feminist thought. And feminist thought in philosophy, in sociology, and so on, is very important and is more related to a politics of knowledge than to the other way of considering gender and feminist activism. So that when you look at the gender and the politics of knowledge, mean we as knowing subject, how our subjectivities are done, and this leads to the work of Karen Barad, of Rosie Braidotti, but before of Donna Haraway. You see, also in practice theory, I use a lot, but other people use a lot, the concept of situated, you know, situated practices, situated knowledge, and so on. But this concept of situatedness is clearly linked to Donna Haraway question and critiques of the God trick, of producing knowledge from nowhere, so keeping the knowledge subject as disembodied, not positions in relation of power, in relation of race, and so on. So the situatedness of knowledge means also that our knowledge and our knowing subject is always partial, limited. So when I study something as a situated phenomenon means also that I'm not claiming to universal knowledge, to the positivistic claims about knowledge, and acceptable knowledge, and which knowledge practices are, and so on. And this has a clear consequence and impact on who is the knowing subject, who is the knowing subject within a research assemblage, so that if our epistemic practices build an apparatus of knowledge producing that makes something appear as a phenomenon, you see, not only we have to inquire at our knowing practices, our epistemic practices, and our construction of the production of the phenomenon, not only a reflexive stance, but also to see how our knowledge is always partial, also situated, also linked to the materiality of the apparatus that we use. And this is a contribution that comes exactly from gender studies as a politics, at the feminist thought in philosophy, in epistemology, but also, if you want, links to a post-anthropocentric view, because the project of decentering the knowing subject was also a project saying that we are accountable for the knowledge that we produce, we are accountable for the world that you produce, so that when Karen Barad talk about ethico-onto epistemology means an ethical stance toward the epistemic practice that we enact, and that our epistemic practices build the ontologies, to say, what we study. So I think that feminist thinking, feminist thought is very rich. And also I should say that it's not recognized as it should. I mean, it's easier that you find the reference to Deleuze and Guattari, and I love Deleuze and Guattari and their Deleuze rereading of Spinoza and the Ethic of Spinoza. But it's easier that you find reference to Foucault, to Deleuze, but less references I was mentioning the big mothers, so to say, but it's the contribution of a feminist thought that is quite radically different from the positivistic assumptions.
There's a lot to muse on there. Elena has a question here, but Elena, why don't you put on your microphone and ask it, because I'm sure Silvia has encountered this issue.
Hello, Silvia. Hello, this is Elena from accounting. Thank you for your presentation and discussion. So my question relates to the paradigms that we have in different disciplines. So I'm talking about, you know, structural paradigm, post-structural paradigm, and the battles that researchers face across the paradigms. So usually there is little understanding between researchers across paradigms. I've experienced it myself when you submit a paper to a journal that is clearly not structural in its ontology and epistemology, but then you receive reviewers' comments that are clearly very structural, in a sense, you know, talking about validity, triangulation, generalizations in the structuralist sense. So do you have any recommendations in terms of how to communicate effectively post-structural research to scholars outside the paradigm?
Thank you, Lena, for your question. It's a pity that I can't see you. Maybe you don't have the video on. And question for your question. Once again, I'm not sure that I have an answer. I recognize the problem, the difficulty of talking across paradigms. And you see, this difficulty is not only across paradigms, but it's also the difficulty of taking a concept and to clarify the way that you understand this concept without, so to say, going back to a definition, so to put it in a box. But if you think, the more that a concept is in use, the more difficult it becomes to use it in a way that talk to a community and to, so to say, to the road that this concept can open. Affect is enough to give you an example that in order to make clear in which way you are thinking and proposing to think about affect, you are going to spend one third of your article only on this task, and this become a problem also of talking across paradigms, also across talking across discipline, because a discipline is just a way of black boxing some epistemic practices in that. So I would say that there is no way out of that. You have to struggle every time in trying to convince the reader that you are working in, so to say, in position your work in relation to the literature, to some other, in relation to the kind of problem that you want to touch upon. So the positioning of the work within a tradition, a disciplinary tradition, what you call a paradigm, what you want to do with what you are presented, is a challenge. And the more that articles are produced, instead of, so to say, simplifying the problem, are just making the problem more complex. And sometimes it's not necessary to make it so complex. But this complexity is also the of, so to say, a publishing strategy, that in order to say something, you have to try to say something new, so that the contribution is a little twist to the concept, but not something that is really breaking. Sorry, I don't have a better answer.
No problem, it's a tricky one. Kate, go for it.
Thank you very much. And hello, Silvia. I'm sorry you can't see me, but I hope you can hear me. My name's Kate Grosser. I have a quick question. So first of all, I've loved reading your work for many years. And as a kind of feminist activist involved in academia, I've really enjoyed in particular your work in 1995 on, which explored the ideas around hypocrisy as a resource for changing gender relations. And I found that very helpful in neoliberal times. To move on from that, just to say, you referred earlier to the importance of various aspects of feminist theory and how it's become more mainstream and accepted. But we still have this problem, and it's particularly pointed out in feminist interpretations of political theory, but I think it applies across the board, that feminist scholarship still largely or often develops alongside rather than as part of mainstream theory, such that it is in effect ignored or its implications overlooked and its insights missed. And we have to keep reinventing the wheel and bringing these same arguments again and again. I'm thinking of the work of Shanley and Pateman in the early 1990s in political theory, but this kind of argument has been repeated, so that in organization research, most mainstream scholarship still continues to be presented as if theories and data were gender neutral. I'm just wondering if you have any comments about that continued marginalization of the really central contributions that feminist and other theories, but for now, feminist theory brings to organization studies and the kind of continued processes of marginalization, so that we have to kind of keep repeating the same points as if they're new. And if you have any comments about how to address that and your experience of that, or how to address it, thank you very much indeed.
Well, dear Kate, you can imagine how sympathetic I am to how you have formulated the problem. I would love to have, so to say, an affirmative answer. The answer is quite simple: to keep going, keep protesting, keep making books, keep making visibility for feminist thinking. And if you want, well, there is a good work that is underway on keeping visible the feminist contribution. At the same time, it looks like a never-ending task, but there is only one solution: to keep going and hoping that, you know, also what is developing like feminist activism in the through the net and through this form of contrasting homophobia, and but also contrasting marginalization of feminist thought in academia is something that we have to do, and maybe for, who knows, forever. That's it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kate. So, Silvia, we're just about at time that we had for this session, but I wanted to offer you a chance to make some final remarks. And I know you are either approaching or on the other side of formal retirement, at least soon. But given the person you are, I suspect you will continue to keep thinking and writing and producing interesting work. So I suspect we're all interested in what's next for you. What are you working on now? What are you thinking about for the immediate future in your work?
Well, I should confess you that it's already 6 years that I am retired. And I took an early retirement because, very simple, I was fed up with academia and the way that our working environments are and are becoming worse and worse. That's it. Stop here. But I have been lucky because in the last year of my retirement, I had a 5-year contract with Oslo University, then 2 years and a half with Helsinki University. And at the moment, I have a 2-year contract with 3 years, I remember, with Mälardalen University in Sweden. And really, these are occasion for me that are very dear to me, because are the opportunity to meet doctoral student, postdoc student, colleagues with whom I can continue sharing experience, thought, like I'm doing with you today. And this is very important for me, because work, that means reading and writing, is what I have done all my life, and still is what I continue doing with passion. For me, it's very important to do it with other people, with other colleagues. And in fact, if you want, the lockdown, because of the COVID, has been very hard for me, because, you know, in the first time I finished all the papers that were in my that were left, I finish everything. And then suddenly I realized that I have so that the meaning of being working for me was not there any longer, because what I missed was and what I was suffering from was the social isolation. So that real the social distance that is not the physical distance was affecting me very, very badly. And so in a sense, I propose and I invite other, I should say mainly feminist scholar, to develop a reflection and also to engage in an experimental writing process where we could share our experience, and we were scattering six or maybe more than six writers scattered around Europe. And so we prepare a paper on COVID as a breakdown of social practices that is out in gender work and organization. And I'm pleased to share with you if you are interested. And one of the editors of this series, this section in gender work and organization, is Alison Pullen from Sydney University, Macquarie University in Sydney. And she has been very active in inviting and promoting feminist thought in this situation, in this pandemic that is a social emergency, not only medical and not only economic, but it's social, because our social practices are disrupted and we cannot think to go back as it was before, like anything happened. No. Our practices are changed and are really changed. And this is also an opportunity to, so to say, to repair the fabric of social practices, introducing innovation. So that I'm trying to work also with another group of managers who have been very active in facing the crisis, the emergency in Emilia-Romagna. And now they are thinking on what can we do in order to provide the services, but introducing social innovation in what we do. So as you see, I need to be in contact with people, because otherwise my work is meaningless. And I like to be active. I like to be active with other people, with other colleagues, and to bring some form of thought forward.
Well, two things. I mean, one, for someone that's been retired 6 years, Google Scholar certainly makes you look very productive over this time. And two, I imagine many of us would be interested in that work when you're ready to share it. I've been thinking about COVID on my own research on co-working, things like this, and I'm sure many of us have been thinking about the short-term and long-term effects of COVID on what we study. There is one more bonus question that my colleague and friend Ash wanted to ask you, so I'll let you ask that, Ash, and then we'll formally close up.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Silvia, for sharing your experience and knowledge. It's quite a privilege. I just want to ask one question about the Goya methodology. In recent studies, especially in organizational studies, we have seen extensive application of the Goya methodology to understand the lived experience of organizational members. So I was wondering, what's your take on the Goya methodology, especially in relation to grounded theory?
Well, I think that I respect his work, and I think it was important for, so to say, giving a sense, giving a trajectory in doing qualitative research and has been a contribution to organization studies and to do case study research. I think that at the moment I am on different on a different track, so to say. Not much of 5 minutes.
Okay, I think your mic's still on. I'll just mute you if that's okay. That was I suspected you might have said that. I mean, maybe it's something to unpack, Ash. But my reading would be Goya or Joya has taken a different track to that, to the things you've been talking about in the last few years. We're just about at time. Ash, sorry, did you have a comment?
No. All good. Thank you.
Yeah. Sylvia, I just wanted to really thank you. Now, we can't see you either now. Something, maybe you can see me, but now your camera has gone off, so we just see a big SG. It's no problem. It's not an issue. We can hear your dulcet tones, and it's been wonderful to have you join us. Thank you for the persistence with the technology. Well, there you are. You're back now.
You see, technology does things by itself. Our dream is to be in control of technology.
This is like one of your papers, yeah?
We are working together. It's a co-work space. Julian, thank you so much for inviting me to this conversation, very lively conversation. Thanks to all the participants. It was a real pleasure to be with you, and you gave me the opportunity to reflect and to go back to what I do, what I have done. So I'm very pleased for this opportunity. Thank you, and I hope that we shall have more opportunities to continue this conversation in the future. So thanks again, Julian.
Perhaps even in person one day. You know, we have many colleagues here.
Well,
on your point of social distance, Sylvia, some of our colleagues that are on this call who've been working together all year have actually never been in the same room. You know, we've never met, including our dean of school who's on the call right now. So any other final comments from anyone before we close down the call?
Just a very warm thanks, Sylvia. This has just been a sheer joy. It's reminding us here in this country of all that we miss, all that we love about academic work, all that we love about the rich, stimulating discussion of ideas amongst friends and colleagues. And it's just, you've filled my heart with joy. It's just fantastic. We've got a long weekend coming up. We get 3 days off, so I just can't think of a better way to start a long weekend that we have all these full and rich ideas to rattle around our brains all weekend. It's just lovely. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you.
All right. Bye-bye, Sylvia. Have a great day in Paris.
Thank you. The same to you. Have a good afternoon and a good evening. Bye, Julian.
All right. Bye.